What you see before you right now is computer-generated image. It doesn't exist. This particular image here, which Warren is acting as a designer manipulating, shows us a three-dimensional view of a part that can be manipulated by moving these knobs. You can see our we can see that without ever having to produce an actual physical part. I'm saying that maybe $1,000 anyway. And so it's really a computer prototype in the back. This you can see here is drawn with lines, which they call their wireframe drawing. We're able to rotate that around, and it helps designers repeat on the scene what the model is. The picture you see here is a little more realistic because we now have had the computer simulate how light will reflect off the surface of the object. The idea here is we can direct this computer at the push of a button to recreate the image from any vantage point and give us a more realistic image. For example, if we had enough time, we could have modeled your ranch in this computer. We could have turned the knob around to walk around and get an image like this at any point. Now, the nice thing about it that we'd like to do with a designer is then you could move the houses around on your ranch without having to do it physically. That's the idea behind this computer model. And this will mean our industries will be able to design products better, faster, and cheaper. And of course, that translates into industrial competitiveness.
How concerned are you, sir?
Obviously, we're concerned with what's going on. We're working.
Is there really a difference between what they did and what we did, sir?
I can't discuss things like that.
Well, do we have any right to be outraged if we did it to them, too? Do we have any right to be outraged?
Mr. President, can you step over this way? I think so.
Why?
One thing we're trying to do here at the research center, stop this right here. Like to get a car, and like
I believe that Ronald Reagan is the greatest president that the United States. He has given the United States a new direction. His own confidence in himself has inspired confidence in his fellow Americans. His composure under fire, his courage with tough decisions, countenance. It is my great pleasure to introduce the President of the United States of America. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you all. And I know you all want to join me in wishing a happy.
There were this many people in the Mackey Arena. Purdue beat IU.
Technology is already producing in the American economy. Just think, for example, that in the little town of Essex Junction, Vermont, engineers in a leading computer firm are pioneering the production of an exceptional electronics. Yes, the American economy is changing dramatically, but one question remains constant, especially among students like yourselves, the question of jobs. So I thought I'd talk first today about how last month in Missouri, I devoted an entire address to this issue. Today, let me simply restate my firm belief that to improve our nation's competitiveness in the world economy, we must strive for that. And I salute you, and I will. Of the future in mind that our administration partnership act, or as we use the initials in Washington, JTPA, the principal congressional author of which was your outstanding senator Dan Quayle. That would serve an additional 700,000 dislocated workers each year. And again, this program would spend public money well, provided workers with training early before they exhausted their unemployment benefits. Permit me to turn now to the deeper question, the underlying question, how can we best fight it in one piece? When some 44 million Americans were employed, yet between 1930 and 1980, a time when our nation made steady and remarkable technological progress, the American economy employed on average some 11 million more workers every decade. And to take still more recent evidence, and when the new dialing and everything came in, there was a great fear but jobs were going to disappear. Well, at the rate of the use of telephones today, if we were still with the old system, there aren't enough women in the United States to man those operator jobs as they do. Yet here we are, just half a century later, and we Americans are enjoying a standard of living undreamed of when I was your age. As for jobs, well, as I said a moment ago, employment during these past 50 years has increased by some 65 million. The potential magical marvels that we take for granted that didn't even exist back then. Computers, space flights, high technology classrooms and laboratories like the ones I saw today. But I guess what I'm trying to say is this. If our nation has made all these tremendous advances during my lifetime, from the flight of Charlie's and the beliefs that have sustained Americans through two centuries and raised our nation to greatness, God, the family, and freedom. And know that in your own minds and hearts, in your own capacity for wonder and imagination, therein lies the true economy. In this land of freedom, my friends, you only have to dream great dreams and come here to start a new life. And all that has been achieved here, all that we've done, could be summed up in something that a man wrote the other day. He said, you can go to Spain to live, but you can't become a Spaniard. You can go to Japan, and you can't become a Japanese, a Greek.
Mr. President, would you join us at the podium? E.T. would like to say something to you and give you some gifts.
Thank you, Mr. President. This is Purdue. I have some gifts for you, and this is Reagan.
I guess you can't hear it very well. E.T. is overcome with emotion. Mr. President, we have here a Purdue mini computer to help you with the budget. Since Mrs. Reagan couldn't be here, we thought she would enjoy for the White House Christmas tree a golden replica of the Boilermaker special. And finally, we would like to have E.T. come home with you to help you with the chores on the ranch and in the Oval Office.